everybody. I'm really pleased that so many people are here to listen to the debate about whether nuclear power will have a role to play in future energy markets. I want you to know that all of this started with a little conversation I had with Lester, who's going to be our moderator. He had spoken at one of our Saturday morning meetings and said something about nuclear power being a possible green power to replace fossil fuel. And I was amazed, and a little bit aghast. And so I asked him about it, and he said he wasn't quite sure where he came down on the issue. And that sparked the idea that we should have a debate so that all of us know a little better where we stand. So it's really Lester who is more or less responsible for all of this, and he's being punished by being our moderator today. Lester has been an active scientist for all his professional life. He has a PhD in cell biology, and he worked as a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, University of Colorado, and at the University of Kentucky. And he is going to introduce our two speakers as they have their first longer introduction. I just wanted all of you to know that I had a very hard time to find somebody who would speak for nuclear power. And that's partly because my friends are on the other camp. So it's not that these people are not around, but it's just that I don't know them. So I finally went to City Lights, and they didn't have speakers. You know that City Lights still is for 14% powered by nuclear power. And so I thought they would know, and they should know. But they did not have anybody to speak, but they referred me to John Duncan, wherever he is. He is here all the way back, standing in the back of Tri-Cities. And John was very, very good in connecting me with Dr. Conca, and the rest is for Lester to introduce. I had no trouble finding a PSR person, so yes. Okay, Lester, all yours.
Actually, Laureen deserves a lot more applause. She's responsible for all of this, and virtually all of it, and she's done a remarkable job. I think we are very privileged to have two speakers who've come quite a distance just for this purpose, to argue the pros and cons of whether we should invest heavily in nuclear energy as a source of electricity. As Laureen pointed out, I actually, believe it or not, those of you who think of me as being rather opinionated, rightfully so, I really am rather neutral on the subject at this point. What we're going to do is we're going to allow each speaker 10 minutes to make a presentation. And then each will be allowed 2 minutes for rebuttal. And that will be followed by question period, questions coming from those of you here who wish to express themselves. And oh, by the way, before we go very much further, this is the season for polling. And so we have created a ballot of unusual sort. I hope you will all participate. On this ballot is the question, how do you feel about nuclear power energy? And you have five choices, ranging from strongly favor, that's the number five. Three is neutral, if you're like me, you would put down neutral at this point. And one is strongly opposed. And then four and two are less strong. So if you don't have a ballot yet, please raise your hand and hopefully you can be given a ballot. Now the interesting, the interesting feature I think, by the way, this is Jim Voss's idea, which I endorse, that we would like you to vote now before you hear the arguments.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
5 is the strongly favor, and the other extreme is strongly opposed is number one. And there is a range. So vote. How do you feel right now on the before? And then later, we'll ask you to vote. After you've heard all the arguments and debate and answers to questions, you will be asked how you feel at that point and see if you have changed your view. And the results will be made public to you once we've done all the tabulations. Okay, that's the order of business. Oh, and after the question period, there will be summary statements from each of the speakers. The first speaker is, toss a coin, I presume, something like that?
No, you decided.
Okay. The first speaker, I will introduce them just in advance of their own presentation, is James Conca, Dr. James Conca. He's a energy and environmental scientist at the UFA Ventures in the Tri-Cities area. He's not only a scientist, but he's a speaker and author. He's also a trustee of the Herman M. Parker Foundation. He's an adjunct professor at Washington State University in the School of Environment and an affiliate scientist at Los Alamos National Laboratory in the geological sciences. He is a science contributor to Forbes magazine and contributes on energy and nuclear issues. Dr. Conca received a PhD in geochemistry from Caltech in 1985. He has a master's in planetary sciences that he obtained in 1981 from Brown.
Actually from Caltech too.
And also a bachelor's in geology and biochemistry from Brown University, which he received in 1979. I now turn the platform over to Dr. James Conca.
Thank you so much. Great crowd, I must say. And I always talk about population because that's the issue. That's the issue. And I've been kind of cycling that for a while. But there's a lot of people. And since the Earth pretty much can take about 2 billion in terms of steady state, 10 billion gets a bit much. So that's what this is all about. And I'll get to that as well. How much energy do we need? I'm a big picture person, so how much energy do we need, and how are we going to get that? I just want to answer the question that you posed, which is, does nuclear power have a role in our energy future? Yes, it does. Of course it does. Most of the existing reactors we have in the U.S. will be good for the next 40 years at least. And the rest of the world is actually moving very aggressively, much more than we are. We have 5 plants under construction right now, but China has 23 under construction. They already have a few dozen. They have 142 proposed by 2030, but they have 400 proposed by 2050. And they simply need to get rid of their coal plants. This is one reason. Now, they have more renewables than anyone else proposed. They have more hydro than anyone else proposed. They need everything, because there's 1.3 billion people, and they need a lot of energy. And others have a lot of proposals going. India is proposing 100 new reactors by 2050. So again, nuclear is going to have a role. I'd like it to have a good role. I'd like us to be the leaders, because we do it better and safer than anyone else. But that's it. So again, I love these nighttime NASA shots, because you can see right away who has energy and who doesn't. Okay, this is what it's all about, what the fighting's all about, what it's always been about. Now, right now, we produce 20 trillion kilowatt hours per year globally. It's a good round number, 20 trillion kilowatt hours. But we will be at least 30 trillion kilowatt hours by mid-century, by about 2040. That's really, really important. Now, right now, we are two-thirds fossil fuel, okay? And with a significant amount of hydro, nuclear, and other, and the other is rising up, of course. And the big question is, what are we going to get to? How are we going to provide $30 trillion without destroying the planet? And it has to be some kind of mix here. It has to be a lot less fossil fuel and a lot less coal. That's the big trick. So gas is okay, it's still a fossil fuel, but it doesn't have a lot of the other nasty stuff that coal has. But, you know, and then we need a lot more renewables, and we need a lot, we need to double nuclear, and we need a lot of other, we need everything. So, you know, whenever it talks about all of the above strategy, yeah, we need all of the above, no question about it. Now, the reason we're going to $30 trillion or more is because of this. 1.5 billion people have no access to electricity whatsoever. They spend about 6 hours a day getting water. 6 hours a day. Okay, that's what this is all about. 2.4 billion people still burn wood manure as their main source of energy, and 3 billion more people are coming on board by 2040. So this is not a trivial number. Okay, these are a lot of people. And you might say, well, who cares about them? We have our energy, who cares? Well, that's kind of nasty, because it turns out it takes about 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year to lift someone up out of poverty. And that's what coal did in the between 1850 and 1950. It raised 2 billion people up out of poverty and gave us the modern world. So I like ragging on coal. Everyone loves ragging on coal, but it's kind of hard to discount what it's done. We just need to replace it now. Now, it turns out that what Paris was about, you know, the Paris Climate Conference recently, all it was about was how do you give these people 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year without giving them coal, and who's going to pay for that? That's all Paris was about. Okay? So it's very, very important. And the only way to eradicate global poverty is to give everyone 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. Now, the nice thing is that energy has never been cheaper. In the history of humanity, energy has never been cheaper in terms of percent of the GDP or how much energy you actually spend a day. So right, and this big drop off was from coal. That's what coal did. Coal made energy cheap. Now, in the 1700s, in order for a French nobleman to get 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year, he had to own 10 slaves, 10 indentured servants, 3 oxen, 4 horses. It's a great calculation for students, by the way. But coal eliminated the need to own someone to get 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. Very, very important. It has nothing to do with what you think of. This is a sociological issue. And it, you know, when science and society meet, it's kind of more interesting. So get me over to talk about that more. It's kind of neat. So what's the fast? So just shout it out. What do you think the fastest growing energy source in the world is?
Solar.
Wind?
Bummer. It's coal. It's been coal, it's always still coal, because it turns out if you are a poor country that has no infrastructure, coal is the easiest thing to install. That's it. Nothing to do with environment, nothing. It has to do with how easy it is to install an energy source when you have no infrastructure to begin with. And that's what Paris is about. We need to stop this because we need to give them the infrastructure. We need to pay for them if we want to save the planet. If we don't, who cares? But if you want to save the planet, you need to give these people the infrastructure they can use to use solar, to use wind, to use nuclear and gas. Because it takes a fair amount of infrastructure to do that. It doesn't take much infrastructure to use coal. That's all it's about. Now, if we kind of blow up the non-fossil fuel, and of course, the second group fastest growing one is gas. So here, fossil fuel are the two fastest growing energy sources, which is not what we kind of want to happen. So if you look at the non-fossil fuel, yeah, nuclear and hydro has always been the only ones that have offset a significant amount of fossil fuel. But of course, the others are coming up. Now, wind's coming up, that's great. I have no doubt it will break records in the next 30 years. But the problem is, it has to get up high enough to decrease this huge amount of coal. And that's not easy. And that's why everyone talks about all of these have to go up. Now, if you're for wind to replace coal just on its own, it's going to take about 10 million megawatt wind turbines, so 10 million of the big turbines. And that's a lot. We can certainly do that. But that's going to take 10 billion tons of steel and concrete. Now, that's 10 times the global output of steel. So the wind is limited by steel, nothing else. I mean, it has some other issues, but it's limited by steel. So we need to plan for this. This is not trivial. If we want to do this, you've got to get steel. That's about 10 times the global output. So, but if we do it all of the above, so wind plus hydro plus nuclear to replace coal,
That's, you know, we can do 3 million, that's a lot easier than 10, and then we need to double hydro and nuclear, which is actually not that hard. DOE actually has a plan to double hydro in America by 2030. So, and again, it's because of this. So wind just takes a lot more steel and concrete than anything else per megawatt hour, and that's okay. It doesn't have any fuel costs. So again, you're either paying for infrastructure or you're paying for fuel. So the non-fossil fuels, most of the cost is in infrastructure. Whereas fossil fuel, most of the cost is in the fuel. And that's why carbon is so bad, because it's all carbon fuel. So how much is this going to cost? It really doesn't matter what the mix is. And again, get me back to talk about this stuff in more detail. But it'll cost the world, regardless of the mix, to come up with 30 trillion kilowatt hours by 2040 is going to cost the world about $75 trillion. Sounds like a lot, but it's actually not that much compared to, this is over that time period. For the United States, it's going to cost about $12 trillion. And again, whether you're fossil fuel or whether you're non-fossil fuel, simply what mix of that $12 trillion? So you're either spending most of it on infrastructure or spending most of it on fuel. And again, the cost, yeah, I hate levelized cost because this includes everything else like depreciation and financing and all this kind of stuff that has nothing to do with what it costs to produce it. This is what it costs to produce electricity. And it's actually not that bad. They're all kind of within the same range. And if you use the investment tax credit and the production tax credit, wind and solar come down. So now they're pretty much all the same. Now, hydro has always been the cheapest, always will be. That's why Washington is so cheap. So really, cost is not the issue. Because if you look at price, the price of electricity is 8 cents a kilowatt hour in Washington State. It's the cheapest in the world for the standard of living we have. And in New York, it's 19 cents. Why? Why is it so high in New York? I mean, these are all about the same now. But it's because of the market forces, whatever. So you have taxes, you have gouging during polar vortexes and things like that. So this is an unregulated market, and Washington State is a highly regulated market. I like regulation. I love PUDs, public utility districts. They're great. You can't gouge someone just because the weather turns bad. Now, there's other costs. So there's environmental costs, you have, you know, healthcare costs, you have other issues. And people talk about the carbon footprint as kind of one of those things, and the physical footprint. And so, yeah, carbon fuel is all about the fuel, so it has a huge carbon footprint. These carbon footprints are all about concrete. It's all about construction. Nothing to do with emissions. It has to do with construction. So concrete is a very CO2-intensive endeavor, and these require a lot of concrete. That's all. Now, the worst thing is the death print. So you've got to push coal off, because coal just kills so many people. So this coal is it. If you need an evil, coal's evil. These deaths are pretty much accidents. So people falling off ladders, people falling off heights, whatever, falling off roofs when they're installing solar. We can fix that. That's easy. This is worldwide. Okay, so hydro kills a lot of people because when a dam fails, hasn't failed in the U.S. to kill a lot of people, but when it fails in other countries, it takes out whole villages and towns, and it's actually quite bad. But in the U.S., things are a lot better. So here we look at coal in China. Now, China's reeling from coal effects. It kills about 600,000 people a year in China. Okay? The United States is a lot less because of the Clean Air Act. And here's hydro, and here's nuclear. So these, the non-fossil fuels, are all about accidents. They have nothing to do with radiation or anything else. It's simply accidents. And again, we do it better in the U.S. than we do elsewhere. And there's China. And it's so bad that they're starting putting up flat-screen TVs, because it's really a bummer not to see the sky for a long time. Okay, good. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Conca. That was very illuminating. The other speaker, of course, is the speaker who is not so enamored of nuclear energy. He's Charles K. Johnson. He is the director of Washington and Oregon Physicians for Social Responsibility Joint Task Force on Nuclear Power. He's an activist, a writer, and a developmental professional with roots in the anti-nuclear movement dating back to the 1970s. Mr. Johnson was the co-author, signature drive coordinator, and field director of an Oregon statewide ballot measure which passed in 1980, placing a moratorium on nuclear power construction until a permanent disposal site is established for the high-level waste from that plant. He later served as regional coordinator for the National Office of the Physicians for Social Responsibility in the 1980s and as executive director of the National Information Clearinghouse Nuclear Free America, based in Baltimore in the 1990s. He has a BA in political science from the University of Oregon, and in addition to his having written a biography of former governor of Oregon, Robert W. Strauss, which was published by Oregon State U, Oregon State U Press. He has been published in the St. John's Law School's Journal of Civil Rights and Economic Development. And he has a publication of note in the Journal of Civil Rights and Economic Development titled A Sovereignty of Convenience, Native American Sovereignty and the U.S. Government's Plan for Radioactive Waste on Indian Land. With that introduction, I turn it over to Mr. Johnson. Thank you.
Thank you for having us here. Very much appreciate this opportunity to talk about this issue with Dr. Conca and the rest of you. Does nuclear power have a role in future energy markets? Yes. Fission and fusion have always been with us. Yes. Some countries and regions will continue to depend upon nuclear-generated electricity for decades, but no, nuclear power will ultimately be outcompeted by cleaner, cheaper, and safer sources of electricity. Yes, solar fusion and geothermal fission are as old as the universe and will play a major role in our energy future. I say this somewhat facetiously, but we do need to remember that fusion power has been perfected long ago and is accessible to us now without having to worry about creating a fusion reactor on Earth. Renewable energy can replace carbon fuels and nuclear power use by 2050. A number of people have been looking at this issue. Most notably, Dr. Mark Jacobson, which I urge you to Google his research. Was published last year in the by the Royal Society of Chemistry. 100% clean and renewable wind, water, and sunlight, all sector energy roadmaps for the 50 United States. And Arjun Makajani did an earlier paper called, actually it was a book, Carbon Free and Nuclear Free. And there's a recent book from Amory Lovins, who's been an advocate of energy conservation as a major energy source for years. And he wrote a book called Reinventing Fire, which also predicts that nuclear energy will not be necessary and will be outcompeted economically. So yes, nuclear power does provide 11% of electricity worldwide, but distribution varies and in many places cannot be easily or rapidly replaced. After the Fukushima accident, Germany chose to end its nuclear fleet and shut down some of the most dangerous reactors that they determined right away, and then planned to get rid of the rest of them by 2022. They, in 2011, got 23% of their electricity, a little bit more than we do in the United States, from nuclear, and have been developing wind and solar at an extremely rapid rate, along with energy conservation. France, which has been sort of the poster child worldwide for developing nuclear energy, gets 75% of its electricity from nuclear, but the new socialist government has pledged to try to balance that a bit and reduce down to 50% by 2025. But again, clearly nuclear will have a large role to play in France for some time to come. Nuclear provides 19% of U.S. electricity, but it's widely varies. In Illinois, it's 52% of electric energy comes from nuclear, which will take time to reduce. In the Northwest, we get about 4% of our electricity from nuclear power currently. So this chart shows the reactor startups and shutdowns in the world. And the green bars are the reactors that were built, the large buildup during the 1970s and 80s of the Generation 2 fleet of nuclear power, then tailing off quite a bit into recent times. You can see the orange bars on top. That represents China, the China effect that Dr. Conca was talking about. China is very bullish on nuclear power. They're also, as he said, bullish on everything, including, unfortunately, coal, but also a lot of wind, solar, everything else. They've been growing so rapidly. That may be ending. We'll talk about that later. But China continues to build nuclear power, so it's obviously going to have a role. Japan, before Fukushima, about 30%, I guess maybe more like 27%, came from nuclear. They plan to bring it all the way up to 40%. But of the 54 reactors that were open in 2011 before the accidents, only four are now operating again, with hopes to reopen 20 more. It had a chilling effect felt worldwide, particularly in Europe, but really everywhere in terms of nuclear power development. The origins of the current nuclear renaissance in the U.S. We've had two administrations, both the George W. Bush and the Barack Obama administration, have been very supportive of nuclear energy. And some of the sort of thinking behind it, the next gen, came up in MIT in 2003, in which they discussed the four barriers to developing nuclear energy going forward: costs, safety, what to do with the extremely long-lived radioactive wastes, and nuclear weapons proliferation, which obviously materials can be used to make nuclear weapons that are created in the process of making nuclear power. New designs and old designs were revisited. These included high-temperature gas-cooled reactors, sodium-cooled waste-burning reactors, or used to be called breeder reactors, and improved design light water reactors. Because they wanted to get going right away, they began looking, at least in the short run, at trying to approve some new light water reactors. There's an intense amount of, because these things are inherently quite dangerous, they have to be heavily regulated. And because our regulators in the United States were familiar with light water reactors, those kind of moved to the head of the line in terms of trying to develop them. The Westinghouse AP1000, the Areva Gen 3 EPR, similar in size to the large reactors that were being built in the 70s and 80s, are now being built. There are four AP1000s under construction in the U.S., in Georgia, and South Carolina. These AP1000s and EPRs in Finland and France are experiencing delays, major manufacturing mistakes, and large cost overruns, which is unfortunately what kind of killed the Generation 2 nuclear reactor development. It wasn't the efforts of the anti-nuclear movement, much as we'd like to take credit, but it really was the financial markets that said, if only half of these actually get built once they're started, these are an unsafe unsafe financial risks. And unfortunately, these new reactors seem to be falling under the same problems. Small modular reactors are the thing that's being considered for Washington State, and they would have some advantages potentially into the design. They're in the design phase. Passive design to require fewer moving parts that can fail. Smaller size means cooling. Extremely hot core can be more easily controlled. A unit can be purchased for less money than a larger reactor, so require less financing costs. And mass production is supposed to bring down the cost of the individual units. So This is a mock-up of the one reactor design that's being considered. The rest sort of have fallen by the wayside. It was developed originally at Oregon State University, and it's owned by Fluor Corporation. Okay, before we jump on this bandwagon, despite a $217 million grant, there's already been some delays in terms of presenting the design to the NRC. They haven't actually officially sent their design to the NRC, so already a delay in that. But they're still talking about opening the first prototype in 2023. They really are the only game in town. Babcock and Wilcox and Bechtel got a federal matching grant, and they actually have canceled anyway because they couldn't find enough financial resources to continue their half of the funding for their research even. So they're not favorable for nuclear right now. Economics are really bad for nuclear. Natural gas and wind generation is making our existing fleet of coal and nuclear plants unprofitable in some parts of the country where they have to compete in the marketplace. The cost of wind and solar continues to decline. Storage options are becoming competitive, and SMRs don't have the economy of scale advantage of building large, that these larger reactors did, to generate electricity to cover their costs. Again, you don't think of economics as being necessarily the most compelling argument, but if you're talking about replacing the existing carbon footprint, economics has to come into play, because if we're spending money on these reactors that we don't spend on something else that's more economic, or if these things don't get finished, if they end up not being reliable, or if accidents occur, you can have you can suddenly lose your main way that you're trying to address the climate issue. It's not a reliable way. This is why Bill McGibbon, who's a longtime person who's been raising the alarm on climate change, has been saying that nuclear energy is not a good way to go. He doesn't support it. And it sounds like I am out of time. Thank you very much.
Okay, now we will have a 2-minute rebuttal from each of these protagonists here. And Dr. Conca, you have 2 minutes to rebut.
Thank you. Good, I like protagonists better than antagonists. The SMR thing is kind of funny because you actually have a huge advantage to small scales. I mean, in terms of safety, they are walk-away safe. So if something happens, you simply walk away, can't melt down, can't do any of that.
We're not hearing you.
Oh, I'm sorry. SMR, small modular reactors, actually have a large advantage because they are walk-away safe. I mean, you can, if something happens, they simply shut themselves down and you walk away. They can't melt down. They certainly can't explode or anything. So they actually are good. One of the issues is that we haven't built a new reactor in 30 years, except the military builds SMRs all the time. So there actually is a huge precedence for small modular reactors. It's called the nuclear navy. They make small modular reactors all the time, about this size too. So we've never had a problem with nuclear navy. So that's not really an issue. I mean, we do this all the time. In fact, the battleship reactors are about this size. Nuclear aircraft carriers about this size, and nuclear subs are a little bit smaller. So we know this very well. In terms of proliferation as well, in proliferation, you cannot make a nuclear bomb or even a dirty bomb from spent nuclear fuel from a commercial reactor. We tried that. We tried very hard to do that in the 60s, and we never made a good one. And that's why North Korea, Iran, no one has ever gone that route. No one would waste their time trying to make a bomb from a nuclear reactor waste. It just doesn't work. If you want a bomb, you either make a uranium bomb using enriched uranium, you don't even need a reactor, like Iran was trying, or you do what North Korea did, and what we did out of Hanford. You build a weapons reactor to make a weapon, okay? You can't do it from commercial power, so that, proliferation has never been an issue. Okay? So, and get me back to talk about weapons. I happen to be an expert on weapons from my Los Alamos days. So it's very fascinating, again, but completely different from nuclear energy. Nuclear weapons, bad. Nuclear energy, good. Nuclear weapons, bad. Okay, and we know that. Thanks.
So I want to address a couple of things that Dr. Conca said. One was the issue of the population going up to 10 billion and the assumptions that arise from that. You know, if that's the case, and that is something that we should be very concerned about, I'm not sure there's any scenario that wouldn't be enormously destructive to our planet with the amount of resources involved in that. And perhaps we should all just stop this debate right now and go out and try and help Planned Parenthood and some other groups that are trying to do something about population. And then this debate would be a lot easier to have. But so the other thing I want to say is that the Chinese plans for nuclear really are not realistic. We had plans like that in the United States at one time. Nixon proposed 1,000 new nuclear plants in 1970 by the year 2000. And we attained just over 100, and we're now down to 99 because of shutting them down. I just want to read, talking about the nuclear navy, part of my presentation that I didn't get to read was Admiral Hyman Rickover was the father of the nuclear navy and was in charge of developing the reactors that were used successfully to power submarines and other ships. And he ended up, by the time he, before he died, after the Three Mile Island accident, concluding that commercial development of nuclear power was not the way to go. He didn't trust it. Because he had the advantage himself of being able to veto, he was given more or less full authority to veto whatever was being done. He had unlimited amounts of money to spend, and his concern and his observation of the nuclear power industry was that because it was the profit motive was involved, and because that safety was going to suffer. And we saw the evidence of that because the GE boiling water reactor was a flawed reactor that was known to be flawed at the time it was being developed in the 70s, but the Nuclear Regulatory Commission allowed it to go forward, and then we saw the results in Japan finally in 2011. Thank you.
I would like to ask about places for the nuclear waste in the United States. And has that been successful?
No.
Okay, very good question.
Who do you want to ask?
Yeah.
You have it directed to either.
Okay.
Dr. Johnson or Conca?
Conca, please.
Yes, nuclear waste, again, we don't have. I have to talk about this, but we know exactly what to do with it, where to put it, how to do it. It's cheap, it's easy. We've been doing it for 15 years that no one knows about in the salts of New Mexico. Yucca Mountain is a terrible place. It's a lousy rock. I worked on it for 25 years trying to make a lousy place work. And, you know, we could do it if you spend $300 billion extra dollars engineering around the fact that you picked the wrong rock. That's okay. It was picked politically, by the way. Speaker of the House, Jim Wright, 1987. Tom Foley. House Majority Leader, they basically said, this new junior named Harry Reid, Harry, it's yours. Harry said, no way, and that was that. So Yucca Mountain's a terrible place. We can do it if we have $300 billion extra dollars to do, but we don't. I mean, we never will. So we originally, National Academy of Sciences originally chose the salts, the Permian Basin salts of New Mexico and Texas, as the one and only place for all nuclear waste. It's a piece of cake. We actually opened WIP. In 99, we, you know, a bunch of Hanford waste, all of the waste from Rocky Flats, a bunch from all the other sites, is in WIP in the salts, a half mile below the earth in a massive salt deposit. It works great. Now we had a leak, didn't have a leak from the repository, we had a drum, and someone put the wrong kitty litter in. It's actually a fascinating subject, I'm not kidding. We use Johnny Cat Rad Labs all the time. It actually works really great. Some non-scientist technician that was loading these drums decided, Johnny Cat's dust, a little bit of dust. I have four cats. I don't know if you're a cat. So, you know, it's dusty, so we're going to use this new dustless cat litter. Sounds great, right? Well, it's not, it's wheat-based. It's organic. It's not inorganic. So it didn't quench the auto-oxidation reactions that we use Johnny Cat for.
And so that, so one drum blew its top. It's kind of like, it didn't explode. It was kind of like a charcoal briquette, just got hot, 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 blew the top. And 7 ounces of material got out. Okay, that's, it's bad, but WIP contained it beautifully, or like it's supposed to. It was supposed to contain this, and it contained it great. But cleaning it up, we'll get it back on track. But all the Hanford waste here, even though we're trying to vitrify it, which is a stupid thing to do for that kind of waste, it's the wrong chemistry, all of that should go to WIP. It was originally intended for WIP, but it got derailed in the 70s because of nonsense.
Mr. Johnson.
Thank you.
You want to comment on this?
Yeah,
I'd like to, and I'm glad you brought up WIP. And I know you worked on that, and were personally involved in helping to design it and so forth. The waste isolation pilot plant was intended to isolate radioactive material indefinitely, for in perpetuity, and it lasted about 15 years before it had its first release into the atmosphere above the plant. It was detected, came through ventilation, and got out of the site. It's still too contaminated underground for them to go down there, and they're not sure when they're going to be able to reopen it. That's 2 years ago that this happened. So it's the kind of thing that, as Dr. Conca said, it was just an error on the part of a Los Alamos person who chose the wrong kitty litter. With nitrogen in it, created nitrates that exploded or had an eruption of some sort. So, but it's the kind of thing that's you always have to get everything right with nuclear. That's the big problem with nuclear. And you can have really smart engineers like Dr. Conca figure out genius things and ways to do it. All it takes is one person to who's less skilled, maybe doesn't have all the information to get it wrong. And that's typically what happens. It was operator error that caused the meltdown at Three Mile Island, which didn't result in a lot of release, but it did destroy the reactor completely. And operator error at Chernobyl. So, not so much at Fukushima. That was bad design, and not anticipating the tsunami and the earthquake. But it's again, you have to get everything right when you do nuclear. If you get things wrong, even if it doesn't release a lot, the shock credibility can really shut it down. And if we're trying to stop climate change, we can't have our main source of energy that we're using to replace carbon suddenly lose its credibility with people who are having to live next to these plants. And that's actually in Japan. What's happened is they have more democracy in Japan in terms of deciding whether plants open or not. They actually can decide at the local level whether a plant stays closed. And that's why they've only been able to reopen 4 plants in Japan since the accident.
Okay, thank you. Jerry?
I actually have 2 questions, but they're both very short. The first one was, you showed the...
Who are you directing this to?
Pardon?
Who's the question?
Either one, but I think Dr. Carlin. You showed a prototype of what you thought was the only nuclear possibility in the future, as far as a plant that Dr. Johnson did. And I just wondered what the rated capacity of that plant is. And then my second question, and I'll sit down, was what in the world does France do with all of its nuclear waste, with all the number of plants that they have?
The small modular reactor that's proposed by NuScale Corporation consists of 50 megawatt reactor suspended in an underground pool of water, and you can put in as many as 12. You probably want to do all 12 because you're going to want to generate as much electricity as possible since you've gone to the expense of building it. So it's basically a 600 megawatt, about a half-sized nuclear plant with 12 individual reactors. In terms of what France is doing with their waste, at one time, they've been separating plutonium out in order to reuse it, for one thing. That's one of the things they've been doing. So the breeder reactor program in France had problems. They had Phoenix and Super Phoenix plants that were supposed to, they were sodium cooled and ended up being not very successful. They shut them down. And a similar type of thing happened in Japan, where they've been separating out plutonium. The remaining wastes, at this point, they still don't have, they haven't settled on a permanent disposal site that I know of, and maybe Dr. Conca can.
It'll be in clay, which is almost as good as salt. But no, in France, I mean, they store their waste. You know, it's easy to store commercial waste. See, the problem with nuclear waste is more than half of our waste in this country is bomb waste, like Hanford. I mean, it's bomb waste. It's peanut butter. It's really gunky stuff. And that's a completely separate thing. Commercial waste is very easy to store. You can store it in full for 4 years until all the fission products are gone, except for cesium and strontium, and then you put it in dry gas storage, and that's good for 100 years. So all the nuclear waste that France has produced, and they produce, you know, almost more than anyone else except us, is stored in a room twice the size of this room. That's it. I mean, nuclear waste is really small. There's not much of it. One good-sized landfill is all you need. You don't need a ton of sites. You just need one, because nuclear fuel is 11 million times more energy dense than coal. So you just don't need very much. So you don't produce much waste. And although it sounds waste, it's bizarre waste, but we know how to handle it very well. Never had a problem with nuclear waste. Okay, so commercial nuclear waste.
Senator Thibodeau, question.
You can call me Pat. I have several questions. Number one, I have yet to believe in perfection in any kind of operation, but that's one. I'm wondering, that I have two serious questions. One has to do with why do we keep hearing that Hanford doesn't have the understanding of really what to do and how much it's going to cost. Finally, I'd like to know what the presidential candidates, have they taken a position on this issue, either any of them?
Yeah, I mean, one of the issues with candidates, and do that one first, is that nuclear has become very politicized because of the war, I mean, because of nuclear weapons. That's where it started, and it just kind of spread into nuclear energy. But they're completely different. And I mean, I'm a social democrat. I'm never closer to Bernie than anything else. But I know nuclear, so you know, I can strip away the political crap and actually understand it. But most people don't. And so it's basically an ideological stand that you take without knowing much about it. Now, the Hanford waste, again, DOE, every time I used to go out and talk about this, I'd get a call from headquarters, slapped upside the head, and said, Jim, stop talking about blah, blah, blah. Because DOE does not make policy. Congress makes policy. So Congress made the policy that we're stuck with in the 80s because of political reasons. And it's stupid. Yucca Mountain's a stupid place. We all knew that. In fact, I was there when they decided that in 87. And we're looking at it, you go, Yucca Mountain, that's the worst place you can have. I mean, it's how stupid. But again, DOE just has to carry it out. So they're not allowed to actually make policy. So they really want to, I mean, they stopped Yucca Mountain. Fortunately, you know, President Obama killed Yucca Mountain for political reasons, but it was born of political reasons, so that's okay with me. It was a good idea to stop that. And so he appointed the BRC, the Blue Ribbon Commission, right? And that, I worked on that with them, back up, reevaluate this based on science, and pick the right place. And they did. And we need to implement those recommendations. Actually, Maria Cantwell and Murkowski are actually trying to do that, okay? But it's hard to get anything through Congress, right? And so again, we know what to do with it, we know how to do it, we know exactly what it's going to cost, and what we're doing now is not it. Okay, what we're doing now is carrying out the decree of Congress in 1987 that said you're going to vitrify this, and you only vitrify waste if you're going to put it in a lousy place. I mean, again, you know, glass is a great waste form if you're going to put it in a lousy place. If you're not going to put it in a lousy place, you're going to put it in the right rock, you don't need to vitrify because the rock is doing what it's supposed to do. So that's why you want it in salt, not in Yucca Mountain tough. And so, but we're vitrifying because that was the path we chose, Congress chose in 1987. Why are we still there? Why can't we make a decision as a country when we learn the right stuff? I mean, this is absurd. We can't see, this is a whole other sociological issue, but yeah.
Mr. Johnson, you want to respond?
Yeah, this is, first off, in terms of the presidential candidates, As I understand it, Senator Sanders is against nuclear, developing nuclear energy. Senator Clinton, I'm not as sure. Her husband was not in favor of it when he was president, but I'm not sure she's made a clear statement on it yet.
She's for it, like Obama, kind of.
Right, exactly. That's kind of what I thought. And then on the Republican side, they tend to be all for it. As Dr. Conca said, it's been politicized. In terms of the tank waste at Hanford and why it's such a problem, this goes back to the thing that Dr. Conca was talking about with France. When you separate out plutonium, they took out plutonium out of the spent fuel that came out of the production reactors at Hanford for making bombs. Instead of taking it out for making new fuel as they were doing in France, they were separating it out with these reactors that they had up at Hanford to put the plutonium into weapons. You end up with very similar waste, depending on your methods, but in the case of up at Hanford, it was, and large volumes of it. I mean, Dr. Conca is correct that there's some portions of the waste stream that are smaller. That's a fairly large stream, waste stream, and an unwieldy one because you've got a lot of solvents in the tank waste that complicate matters. You got thousands of isotopes in varying concentrations and varying tanks that make it a lot more complicated to figure out what to do with it. And they chose, as Dr. Conca said, a one-size-fit-all plant that they're trying to force all of this unlike waste through, and now that they've spent so much money on it, they're afraid to abandon it, and they're trying to figure out some way to make it work. Yeah. And it is a mess. And the way it works at Hanford is you've got contractors that get a contract for 5 years, and at a certain point when they realize that it was hopeless, they would just wait out the clock and hand it to the next contractor, and that's kind of how it's gone. It's been very lucrative for the contractors, but not good in terms of getting the job done.
But it's meanwhile okay. Ruining the Columbia River.
Well, no, it isn't. But some of it is leaking out and could get to the river if they don't do something about it.
In the year 4000, but nothing's getting out now.
Next, Gene, you have a question?
I can quite understand, Dr. Johnson. If we don't have nuclear power, how are we going to get the power that we need?
I'm not Dr. Johnson, I'm a Bachelor of Arts.
Bachelor
not
Johnson.
Even a Bachelor of Science. But I have been looking at this issue for a while. How do we get it? Well, as I said at the very beginning, there are scenarios that are out there, and the most detailed ones in terms of looking at completely eliminating nuclear and the carbon sources have been done by a man by the name of Mark Jacobson at Stanford. And what it is it's a combination of using less energy, figuring out more efficient ways to do things. Our lighting has, with LEDs, the lighting needs now have shrunk enormously. I mean, they're like four times less than what they were, 15, 20 years ago. And if we develop that, and interruptible power, getting factories approval to shut down at certain times and run at times when power is being generated. Wind and solar energy, as they're doing very aggressively in countries like Germany, that has gone from and now that there's more electricity generated in Germany than by wind and solar than there is by nuclear, and that's been as a result of their policies there that's encouraged it. And that's a country that, by the way, does not get great solar, which is fascinating. They're one of the, until recently, I think they were had the largest amount of solar. Now China has eclipsed them because of China's enormous size, but they're not the most favorable country for solar energy, and yet they've been a leader in that area. We're even more favorable here in the Pacific Northwest than they are in Germany, believe it or not. So, and the final thing is replacing liquid fuels with biofuels. And these would have to be, in order for them to really be useful, they'd have to be quick turnaround in terms of the carbon cycle. You can't take 100-year trees that take 100 years to grow and chip them up and then hope 100 years from now you'll replace that carbon. It has to be something that sucks up the carbon fast enough that it isn't adding to the problem.
And we agree, but just in terms of scale, you can't do it all with renewables. You absolutely cannot, for a variety of logistical reasons and material. So, again, get rid of carbon, that's the worst thing, and bring everything else up, and you're going to need a significant amount of nuclear. Now, Germany, that's fine, but they actually buy nuclear power from France. So, again, they have the whole grid of Europe to buffer them, and you need that to have renewables, and that's fine, but you need a certain amount of base load along with renewables. You can't do it all with renewables. You just can't. And in terms of climate change, I mean, Jim Hansen, you know Jim Hansen, right? I mean, he is absolutely for doubling or tripling nuclear, and now he's being attacked as a climate denier.
Not a climate
denier. Or no, yes, he's being attacked as a climate denier, which is absurd.
People of the house.
Considering the total cost of building a nuclear reactor, how does that compare to the cost of solar and wind? Total cost, start to finish.
It's actually a little cheaper, okay, in terms of construction. See, the thing is you have construction, okay, and then you have operations and maintenance, and then you have fuel. So even though, you know, wind and solar are very expensive to build, once you build them, you don't have to fuel them. So again, the longer you run renewables and the longer you run nuclear, the longer you run them in time, the more cost effective they become, because most of the cost is in construction. Fossil fuel, it's, you know, gas plant, you can throw up a gas plant overnight. It's just amazing how quick and cheap you can build a gas plant. The problem is you have to fuel it. So the longer you run coal and gas, the less cost effective they become, because all the cost is in the fuel. So again, you either have infrastructure costs or you have fuel costs. So the non-fossil fuels are best because you have no fuel, and nuclear fuel is cheap. So you have almost no fuel costs, but you have large construction costs. Whereas fossil fuel, you have low construction costs, but huge fuel costs. In fact, gas actually turns out to be the second most expensive form of energy in the long run, because even at gas prices at, you know, $3.50 a MMBTU, it's actually very expensive to run a gas plant because of the fuel. So that's why in New York, during the polar vortex, they could charge 100 cents a kilowatt hour and gouge everyone, because they can peak. They're called peaker plants. Gas is always peaker plants. So when you need it, gas will step in, but man, they make you pay through the nose, because gas, even at $3.50 a MMBTU, is still very expensive. So when it goes up, it'll take a while, but when gas goes up, it's going to be very expensive. And we will probably be a natural gas nation at that point, which is what I fear, that we're going to replace everything with natural gas, and then when the price goes up, like it will, we're going to be stuck. That's better than coal.
Hey, I have a question for people in the house.
I'm sorry. Can I also respond to that? I'm sorry. One of the things that I first wanted to say was just a quick response to the Germany importing nuclear electricity. Actually, Germany currently is a net exporter of electricity throughout the European market.
It's because
this is something that you do need to have some way to send when you have large bulges of wind and solar. You have to be able to sell it somewhere, and they have the rest of the European market to do it. So, secondly, the whole issue of costs. Right now, nuclear power that's already built, where you don't even have the construction cost anymore. The operation and maintenance costs of nuclear power plants in many parts of the country, it is not favorable compared to wind. And wind is one of the big problems, actually, in Illinois for one of the largest nuclear companies, Exelon, because it's, as Dr. Conca said, once it's built, its cost is nothing. You know, the wind doesn't cost anything to operate. And these aging plants need maintenance. We talked about they were built, some of them 30 years ago, 40 years ago. That's 40 years is how long they were supposed to actually run. And now the cost of maintaining them is coming due. So they have additional repair costs right now. And they're losing to wind and solar. The city of Austin made a large solar buy that's much cheaper than it's operating its South Texas plant, where it's getting some of its other power.
Well, only because of tax credits. Yeah, it's cheap to operate wind. We get a 2.3.
This was solar, a solar.
And solar gets a 30% tax credit from the feds for building. So yeah, if you get tax credits, that's fine. But it, all that does is switch the cost from the ratepayers to the taxpayers, and no one notices that because the taxpayers are spread out across the United States.
I think one
I love taxing. I mean, I'm a big tax person.
The Price-Anderson Act, which caps the accident cost for nuclear power at, I believe it's $5 billion, and it is a huge subsidy for nuclear energy. Without that insurance of the federal government backing nuclear power, none of these plants would have been built in the first place. So we're talking about subsidies in all of these forms of energy.
So my question has to do with the 15,000 abandoned uranium mines that are polluting our air and water in the 15 western states. And if you factored in the cleanup of those abandoned uranium mines, most of which were, well, 8,000 of which were not Department of Energy for bombs, they were for nuclear power plants. If you factor that in, as well as the cost of decommissioning and cleaning up nuclear power plants, how does the cost equation come out then over the whole life cycle of nuclear?
Would you please stand up? Apparently, you will be heard better.
It doesn't increase the cost very much. I mean, actually, clean up and waste disposal, that's less than a penny a kilowatt hour over the life. Most of those uranium mines were for bombs. I mean, they really were bombs in the 50s and 60s. And yeah, we don't buy our uranium from the US, and we don't need to, because we have lousy gray ore here. We buy it from Canada or Australia. And that's, you know, that's fine. So we should not be mining uranium in this country anymore. Don't need to.
Uranium mining is something that's frequently not discussed in terms of the pollution footprint and also the cost. We do have these abandoned uranium mines, some of which were for nuclear power. I'm not in favor of having uranium mill tailings left uncleaned up in Canada or anywhere else for that matter. You have countries like Niger and Namibia that are that have no environmental controls, and communities have been devastated by uranium mining. So that is definitely something that that needs to be considered when we talk about the cost of nuclear energy, whether it's to the people living near these uranium mines or to the rest of us, whether it's the cost of trying to clean it up or the environmental cost and health cost to those people if we don't.
Does anyone have a question?
I had a couple of questions along those lines, what you were just talking about. You know, is nuclear power actually green energy? If you factor in all the carbon that it takes to mine all that and all the, you know, moving all that ore and everything, you know, all the carbon, is it actually green energy? That's the first thing. I haven't heard that addressed. The second thing is that I've been hearing more and more about the fact that we're past the point now where we're going to get to 1.5 degrees increase without sucking carbon out of the atmosphere. And you mentioned about all the cement that it's going to take to build this. But I haven't heard anybody talking about the cement could be, you know, made to suck carbon out of the atmosphere. So is that on anybody's radar?
No. It's too difficult to get CO2 out.
Just hold, please.
Okay. It's too difficult to get CO2 out of the atmosphere. You really need to stop putting it into it. And you know, yeah, you can use ammonia. We tried some things, but pretty much the Earth has carbon cycles, and this is the issue with global warming. More carbon has been in the atmosphere in the past, you know, 500 million years, a lot more carbon. It's been a lot warmer, but it's the rate of change. It doesn't matter what the absolute carbon content in the water, absolutely in the atmosphere is, it's the rate of change. Biota doesn't like fast change. So when we've been just throwing CO2 in the atmosphere like crazy for the last 100 years, and what's that done is changed too fast, and that's when things go extinct. So it has nothing to do with the absolute amount. Now the Earth can recover easily, but it takes about 1,000 years because CO2 mainly ends up in marine rocks. It ends up in rock. Okay, so but you have different cycles. The cycle in the atmosphere is about 4 days. The cycle in between the atmosphere and the ocean is a couple of weeks. The cycle between the atmosphere, sorry, the ocean and rocks is about 1,000 years. The cycle between CO2 in the atmosphere and old growth forests is about 400 years. So you get all these different cycles going on, and all you're doing is we're pumping it too much in the atmosphere so that those cycles cannot take it out.
May I interject? Yeah. I believe the questioner really meant to ask you, what about all the CO2 that's being produced in formation of concrete and steel
renewables and nuclear, most of the CO2 is from cement production. It's almost nothing else. And, you know, mining of uranium, it takes so little uranium that the mining is, you know, scale-wise, is nothing compared to coal or even to steel. When you mine steel, it's also very nasty. So you get acid mine drainage and things like that. So, but yeah, we have not solved the taking CO2 out of the atmosphere. We're not going to, because it's too expensive, it's too difficult, and the volumes are so huge. And also the differences are so huge. We talk about, you know, we were at 300 ppm, now we're at almost 400 ppm. Well, that's ppm. I mean, the difference between 300 and 400 chemically is really low. So the idea of taking it out of the atmosphere just 100 ppm, it's really, you know, technically too difficult. You just have to stop putting it into the atmosphere. But it's too late for the 2 degrees. It's too late.
So I'm actually going to agree with Dr. Conca about not wanting to, actually figure out engineering ways to try to get CO2 out of the atmosphere.
That's right.
There's some real dangerous concepts being thrown
cement. Carbon sequestering cement.
Okay, all right. Well, I'd be very interested in learning more about that then. That's a little different than playing with our seeding clouds or seeding oceans and so forth. That sort of stuff scares the hell out of me, honestly. But because we don't know enough of what we're doing to run those experiments. The other issue was the footprint of nuclear power and how much it takes. It's not significantly different than the others. I know some anti-nuclear people try to make the argument that it has a large carbon footprint, and it doesn't have a zero carbon footprint, but right. Nothing does. And so that's not an argument I really try to make, because there's a lot of different ways to calculate that, and I don't think it's our strongest argument against nuclear energy at all. I think to me it's the waste problem and the potential for accidents, and then and the cost and the fact that accidents could derail our entire carbon reduction plan.
Question from Alice.
Can you tell us how many states and therefore places that actually welcome the storage of nuclear waste?
Maybe New Mexico and Texas. They're vying for it. Southeast New Mexico, they want to do an interim storage, and they want to actually just dispose of it in the salt there. West Texas also wants that. They actually have a nuclear waste disposal site there now, but it's not for high-level waste. So again, it's kind of how do you categorize your waste in order to regulatorily get it to where you want. But Texas and New Mexico is probably where it's going to be, and it should be. Now, people talk about deep borehole disposal. You've heard of deep borehole disposal. Yeah, I mean, it's tough because it's hard to dig a hole 3 miles deep. But if you do dig a hole 3 miles deep and you pack it correctly, it's not coming out in a million years. So again, the deeper you go, the better it is. And if you actually do go to deep borehole disposal, then every state can have its own disposal, which is why Congress is against it. Okay, because all of the states want to shove it onto one place, right? Because they don't want their state. So again, if you there are 32 states that have nuclear power plants and have waste. So if you say, well, you can have your own deep borehole for your waste, well, Congress doesn't like that, okay? Because they want to give it to New Mexico or give it to Texas or something. So again, politics is more important than science in these issues, and you got to deal with that. But I do want to say there's no such thing as a free lunch. I mean, you know that, right? There's no such thing as a free lunch. So it's always, you know, better or worse or whatever, but you need to choose which one you want.
Yeah, I'm actually going to I concur that it seems that, that the states of Texas and New Mexico have, they've had their battles, and the people who want waste sites have been successful, and now there are employees employed in both of these communities accepting waste, and so there's an economic interest in bringing more to those sites. Whether or not they're the very best sites or not, I mean, that's the whole, they've gone from trying to stick it to one place, as they did with Yucca Mountain in Nevada, to moving to try and figure out where they can move waste voluntarily, sometimes on an interim basis. They're looking for some temporary monitored retrievable storage sites, above ground sites. That way they don't have to make a decision about the ultimate disposal. They try to find some community that wants money to take it. At one time when I was working for Nuclear Free America, there was a government plan to get Native American reservations to take it because of the economic benefit. And it was accepted at one point by the Mescalero Apaches, but eventually they allowed a public vote on their reservation and voted it down. That was also in New Mexico. But one tribe did want it, the Skull Valley Goshutes, in a tribe of 100 people in Utah, but they were eventually blocked by the state of Utah and the politics of that state, and I believe in the George W. Bush administration that that option was completely shut down because of the influence of Utah politicians. So as Dr. Conca says, this is a very politicized issue, and shouldn't be. It should be based on science. He and I disagree about the science of salt. He knows more about it than I do. In terms of the results, I would have to say that I have talked to Don Hancock from the Southwest Research and Information Center, who doesn't agree with Dr. Conca and has studied it very carefully. And so maybe we can just agree to disagree on that.
I just want to say,
I'm going to take advantage of personal privilege here and ask a question of my own. This relates to an article that appeared in the scientific publication Science not long ago. And there, this article says that thorium should be considered as the next fuel, nuclear fuel. And the reason it's given, it says that compared with uranium, the standard reactor fuel, thorium, is more abundant and harder to divert to weapons production, and it yields less radioactive waste. Would you, each of you, please comment about that?
Kind of. I mean, you know, India is really big on thorium because they have a ton of thorium. They don't have uranium, so they like thorium. But thorium is a less efficient fissionable element. So it doesn't work as well. You have to control it a little bit more. The waste is different. It doesn't generate thorium, but it generates uranium-233, which is really nasty.
Yes.
And you know, okay. I mean, you're going to have some waste. There's no question you're going to have waste.
There's less.
Yes, there's less. Uranium-233 is really nasty. Okay. So I'll take plutonium over uranium-233 any day of the week. So work with both of them. Absolutely easy. So, but this idea of diverting to weapons, you've got to get that out of your mind. I mean, that you cannot make a weapon from commercial nuclear fuel, period. That's why all the waste at Hanford, those were weapons reactors. See, the thing about weapons, and get me back to talk about this, because it's fascinating, but the thing about weapons is that you run a weapons reactor for 6 months, and you immediately take out the fuel, because if you run it any longer, you start building in daughter products like plutonium-241, which are poisons, and you can't make a bomb with those, and you can't separate those. So again, a weapons reactor, commercial reactor, completely different. You cannot make a weapon from nuclear power waste, and no one has ever, well, we tried, but you know, we showed everyone you couldn't. So no one's ever tried that. So in weapon states, again, Iran, even Libya, Iraq, when they were trying, no one even would try to make a bomb from weapons waste. In fact, Iran just fired up its Bushehr power reactor. We don't care. You can make a weapon from it. Okay. So again, weapons different than waste. I mean, different than power.
You have any comment about thorium?
Thorium. I agree with Dr. Conca. There are real problems with thorium. In addition to the fact that you generate uranium-233, which, as he said, is very nasty. It's very dangerous for the workers because it emits a lot of radioactivity. So it adds to the radiation burden of the workers significantly over operating a light water reactor using uranium. We have no thorium fuel cycle. That's the biggest drawback to, even if you wanted to do that and to figure out a way around that you thought was acceptable to deal with this additional radiation. We don't have, you have to build an entire infrastructure in order to mine and mill the thorium and everything else, and that's a lot of additional science and work that really hasn't been done yet, so it doesn't seem very realistic. The other thing that I wanted to say about the point he raised about not being able to use the waste, there are a couple different ways from commercial reactors for making a bomb. A couple different ways that a nuclear power country can make bombs. One is by separating out the plutonium, and it is more difficult to get the pure plutonium you want if you let it sit in the reactor for longer periods of time. There's nothing that stops somebody who's built one of these reactors, though, to maximize their way of getting plutonium out. So obviously the United States is watching what Iran's doing with their reactor. The other way is by the enrichment process with uranium. You can make uranium bombs. The bomb that destroyed Hiroshima was a uranium bomb with uranium that was separated at Oak Ridge.
Without a reactor. No reactor.
That's an interesting point. But yes, and then plutonium was used to destroy Nagasaki plutonium was generated at Hanford. But the big fear was this uranium enrichment process. That now the Iranians have agreed to reduce significantly.
Right. Now the Iran nuclear deal is brilliant, by the way. I mean, if you want to talk about that, we'll talk about that another time. It's a brilliant deal. I can't believe we've got such a good deal.
I'm afraid we don't have any more time for questions. Unfortunately, we do have a time limit. Before asking the gentleman to summarize, I want to first acknowledge the wonderful work of Claudia Crawford and keeping time. Very vital. Each of the gentlemen now has 3 minutes to summarize, and we'll begin with Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm going to use the podium because I got something to look at. So, you've heard a lot, you've been very patient. Thanks for giving us this opportunity. I guess maybe I'd like to close with a quote from Admiral Hyman Rickover that's at the end of my presentation I wasn't able to get through to. He originally wrote this, and you can see if you Google it on the web, you can see this in full. He wrote it in 1953 when he was first beginning to work on nuclear power for propulsion of naval reactors, and then read it into the record at the Atomic Energy Commission congressional hearings in 1970. And I'm just going to read some excerpts from it. He titled it Paper Reactors versus Real Reactors. He says, an academic reactor, a reactor plant, always has the following basic characteristics. One, it is simple. Two, it is small. Three, it is cheap. Four, it is light. Five, it can be built very quickly. Six, it is very flexible in purpose. Seven, very little development will be required. It will use off-the-shelf components. Eight, the reactor is in the study phase. It is not being built now. On the other hand, a practical reactor can be distinguished by the following characteristics. One, it is being built now. Two, it is behind schedule. Three, it requires an immense amount of development on apparently trivial items. Four, it is very expensive. Five, it takes a long time to build because of its engineering development problems. Six, it is large. Seven, it is heavy. Eight, it is complicated. Unfortunately for those who must make far-reaching decisions without the benefit of an intimate knowledge of the reactor technology, it is much easier to get the academic side of an issue than the practical side. For a large part, those involved with the academic reactors have more inclination and time to present their ideas and reports and orally to those who will listen. Those involved with practical reactors, humbled by their experiences, speak less and worry more. And I'll leave my PowerPoint. I expect Dr. Conca would be willing to do that too. We can leave it here if people want to maybe send it to one another. They can look at it and study it. You can see that I have references for my stuff on the small modular reactors. I have four different references if you want to look them up. The main point I would make and leave you with is that we're the 2003 MIT conference that was attempting to revive nuclear energy said that there were four barriers to them. One was safety, one was cost, one was waste, and one was proliferation. And I don't believe, you know, possibly some of these new reactors may be safer. Time will tell. They certainly show some promise in being that way. But I don't think any of the three other problems have really been fully addressed or solved. And that's why PSR has taken a position against nuclear energy nationally and locally as well. And why we're concerned that that this option be we believe this option should not be chosen going forward. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I want to just talk about the future of nuclear, because that's kind of the question that we were posed. And yeah, when everyone talks about old reactors, I mean, it's like talking about a 486 computer in the 80s, okay? I mean, no one's going to build a 486 anymore, and that's fine. We're going to build new ones. And all the new ones have addressed all of these issues. And we, you know, talk about thorium and molten salt reactors. There's all these different designs. We've actually built test reactors of almost all of them, and that's fine. But pretty much, we know from 60 years of experience, especially in the nuclear Navy, it's funny that, you know, Rick Over did say that at the end, but that was before we really started a major nuclear build. He did this wonderfully. I mean, the nuclear Navy never had a problem. They're all small modular reactors. They're really great. And you don't want to, all the proliferation issue has to do with recycling, reprocessing your waste. You don't need to recycle. You don't need to reprocess. I mean, there's just not much waste anyway. It doesn't get you very much. Much better do what Bill Gates is doing. You know Bill Gates' nuclear company. You know Bill Gates bought a nuclear, or actually formed a nuclear company 3 years ago? He actually, you know, talked to his foundation and he said, we haven't done much on energy. Do some research. What should we do? And they came back and said, new nuclear, but fast reactors. So he basically pulled $50 million out of his back pocket, easy for him, and said, hire me the best available 40 nuclear engineers and scientists in the country, put together a nuclear power country called TerraPower. It's in Bellevue. It's actually neat. It's pretty cool. And design and build the best reactor. Now, it's a fast reactor. Now, fast reactors are you know, the Russians have built them for their nuclear Navy forever. It can burn old fuel. So the whole idea is we go to fast reactors in the future, and it burns the spent fuel we have from our present reactors. You get about 10 times as much energy out of it, and the waste is much, much nicer, a lot nicer than thorium waste. So again, you know, we have a future. We need to do this. No one thinks about, you know, building a 1980 wind turbine. No, we're not going to build a 1980 nuclear reactor. We're not going to build anything old. We need new designs. This is what we're good at in engineering. So we come up with new designs, we test them, we build them, and we pick the best ones. And by the end of the century, we should be at all fast reactors like Bill Gates and burning our old fuel from the old reactors. So that's the future of nuclear. Thanks.
Thank you all for, ignore my buzzer. It's been a splendid occasion. A splendid occasion, and as a small token of our appreciation, I want to give each of you an opportunity to suck more carbon out of the atmosphere. Yeah. Don't forget your balance.
This is green.
This is a green plan.
Really quickly before you all leave, I wanted to give a special thank you to Lorraine Nussbaum for putting this all together today, getting our speakers and organizing Lester and Claudia.